Good evening, everyone. My name is Evan Douglas. I'm the Dean of the School of Architecture at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. It's a great pleasure and honor to introduce tonight's distinguished speakers, Teddy CRUZ and Fona Forman, principals in the research-based political and architectural practice eStudio. Recognized for their grassroots revolution aimed at overcoming a longstanding culture of discriminatory planning and zoning policies throughout the U.S. that has contributed to the shameful inequities facing marginalized communities, their unique critical praxis proposes the radical reassessment of the role of architecture today. Deeply committed to our profession as an ethical endeavor in support of empowering informal communities in neglected urban areas, much of the firm's work since its inception has concentrated on the development of ingenious bottom-up urban tactics and organizational strategies capable of revitalizing border territories, particularly invested in the U.S.-Mexico border as a uniquely contested site of socio-cultural, political, and economic tension. The firm has established a legacy of collaboration with local NGOs and nonprofit organizations, as well as governmental officials, to develop a variety of inspiring and impactful art and architecture interventions, cross-border community stations, and education-based public spaces that have shown to serve as catalysts for social change. Credited for being visionary in the sense that CRUZ and Forman were invested in the underlying promise of architecture as a deeply social project well before it became universally embraced. Their innovative and creative efforts over many years, emphasizing the important role of urban conflict and informality as sites for engaging new forms of design, public policy, and civic infrastructure, represents as new knowledge an invaluable asset to our profession and the world at large. Teddy CRUZ is a professor of public culture and urbanism in the UCSD Department of Visual Arts. Fona Forman is a professor of political theory and founding director of the Center on Global Justice at the University of California, San Diego. Their work has been exhibited in prestigious cultural venues across the world, including the Museum of Modern Art in New York, the Herbert Bueno Center for the Arts in San Francisco, the Cooper Hewitt National Design Museum in New York, the Center for the International Cultural Exchange in Berlin, and the M+ in Hong Kong. They represented the United States in the 2018 Venice Biennale. Their publications include their co-edited book, Informal Market World's Reader, The Architecture of Economic Pressure, and two forthcoming monographs, Top Down, Bottom Up, The Research and Practice of eStudio, Teddy CRUZ and Fona Forman, and The Political Equator, Unwalling Citizenship. Please welcome Teddy CRUZ and Fona Forman to RPI.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Evan, for that really sensitive and generous introduction. We're delighted to be with you here. Teddy, you'll start the slides?
Yes.
Perfect. All right. So we want to share our research-based practice embedded at the San Diego-Tijuana border. Teddy and I will sort of tag team over the next period. So we really see this zone as a microcosm of all of the injustices and indignities experienced by vulnerable people across the globe. Political violence, climate disruption, accelerating migration, rising nationalism, border building everywhere, deepening inequality, and the steady decay of public thinking. We live and work a few miles from the child detention centers that will forever stain this period of American history. San Diego, Tijuana has become a lightning rod for American nativism. And although the news cameras are gone, tens of thousands of Central American migrants wait at the wall for asylum that never comes, reviled by the Mexican public as a nuisance, you know, as an infestation. The language is just terrible. Or else they sit in US detention centers as tools of deterrence separated forcibly from their children, and exposed to a raging pandemic. It's been particularly devastating in recent years to witness the emotional impact on children, you know, their fear and, you know, their inevitable psychic internalization of being socially and morally marginalized. Hopefully there's relief on the horizon, remains to be seen, but the prospect of more border porosity in the next period is drawing even more people north right now, with misinformation circulating on social media. Conditions are really intensifying every day, and climate change will inevitably accelerate these flows in the years to come. A recent UN survey found that 72% of arriving migrants at our southern border are agricultural workers, and that agricultural instability was a major factor in their decision to walk north. So global justice is an intensely local experience in our part of the world. Now, against these local atrocities, border communities and activists on both sides of the wall continue to confront and to productively circumvent unjust power. Some of this contestation is about sanctuary and protecting people who are targeted by the state. Some of it is about working through the courts and the detention centers and other institutions of power to advocate for people who are already ensnared in the net of political violence. Some of it takes the shape of bottom-up civic agency that exposes and counters unjust power, confronts hateful political narratives, and transgresses boundaries. And much of it arises informally through everyday collective practices of adaptation and resilience in conditions of scarcity and danger. Over the years, we've accompanied some of this sort of bottom-up emancipatory transgression and eruptions of democratic will in close partnership with agencies at the front lines. In recent years, these struggles have also attracted artists and cultural producers from around the world to engage in acts of performative protest. But we've been mostly critical of this uptick in ephemeral cultural action that sort of dips in and out of the conflict. They tend to be extractive in their processes, and their impacts on public consciousness kind of as fleeting as the Instagram posts they generate. What happens the day after the happening, you know? Instead, we've been advocating for a longer view of resistance, a more systemic approach to the drivers of injustice, and more strategic thinking about cultural, institutional, and spatial transformation in the border region. The UCSD Community Stations is a project that we'd like to share with you tonight. These commitments have culminated in this project over years. Essentially, they're a network of public spaces located in vulnerable neighborhoods across the border where universities and communities meet to share knowledges and resources and collaborate on research, dialogue, cultural and educational activities, as well as urban design build projects in the city. The community stations are the field-based social engagement arm of our research-based design lab at the university. So here we are with our team, with some of our community partners in Tijuana, just before COVID-19 hit. We have several core commitments as a university-based practice that comprise a community stations model, which we think is highly replicable for universities everywhere. I will introduce those commitments. Teddy will then take you on a tour of our four UCSD community station sites. And then I will conclude with a few words about our programming at these sites and how they link our local border context with sites of conflict across the world. So to begin, we localized the global. We've always resisted the idea that global justice is something that happens out there somewhere, you know, in the world. Living and working where we do, we don't need to send our students far away to learn about territorial conflict, migration, poverty, and climate justice. we are minutes away from an international border in crisis. And this enables an amazing proximity between campus and field, between theory and practice, what we like to think of as a critical proximity. Of course, going local here means recognizing ourselves as a region, a site of interdependence. Despite the wall and the ugly political rhetoric that's designed to divide us, we are a binational ecology of flows and circulation, and our future is intertwined here. Air, water, waste, health, culture, money, hope, love, these things don't stop at walls. We build trust bridges, long-term partnerships between our university and border communities. We're not like flaky university programs that sort of come and go, diagnosing crises, extracting data, and then disappearing. We don't disappear. We're there for the long haul. Relatedly, we decolonize knowledge. We're keenly attuned to power dynamics when universities with resources arrive in communities. And we're critical of both extractive research methods and humanitarian problem-solving missions. We don't do applied research, and we don't do charity. We're not a service learning program. Academic culture is filled with what we think of as vertical assumptions, that we know more, right? That we are trained to solve the world's problems if only they would listen to us. We've been committed to horizontal practices of co-production, engaging communities as partners with knowledges and resources. Everyone contributes, everyone learns, and we do things together that no one can do alone. Along these lines, universities really too often take for granted the resources communities invest when they work with us: time, space, social capital, labor, knowledges. As a matter of epistemic justice and labor equity, these contributions need to be validated and compensated. We curate two-way flows, inside out and outside in, unsiloing the campus, inviting activists and community leaders into the campus to teach with us, and ultimately thinking outside the box, literally, about what it means for a university to commit to diversity. Cultivating skills of cultural sensitivity, empathy, and awesome respect. These are skills that we've learned are best understood in situ. Today's challenges demand intersectionality, but everything we do on migration, climate change, environment, health, labor, education, urbanization, everything is refracted through the lens of social transformation. Everything we do is cultural. For us, it's about changing hearts and minds, tackling inequality by increasing public knowledge about the roots and springs of injustice, and growing connected, civically engaged border communities capable of collective action, advocacy, and productive contestation. Ultimately, we are committed to building a cross-border citizenship culture, a sense of belonging that is not defined by the nation state or the documents in one's pocket, but by the shared interests and aspirations among people who inhabit a violently and indeed artificially disrupted civic space. Those who benefit from narratives of separation and mistrust prefer that we remain a fragmented public, that the idea of, you know, citizenship divides us rather than unites us. We seek to inspire more inclusive imaginaries of coexistence and cross-border citizenship in this contested territory. Our cultural aspirations are inspired by Paulo Freire and Augusto Boal and a 20th century lineage of Latin American civic experimentation and urban pedagogy. In contexts of dramatic violence and social fragmentation, cities like Porto Alegre, Brazil, and Bogota and Medellin, Colombia, sought to heal the wounds of history and to mobilize a cohesive civic identity through participatory cultural action. The way Antanas Mockus in Bogota, for example, used street mimes, urban games, and theatrical public disruptions to transform urban norms from the bottom up. Or the way Medellin, Colombia, transformed urban remainders and forgotten zones into vibrant civic spaces that prioritized access and education. Like Medellin's now legendary library parks, our community stations represent a model of urban co-development between public universities and community organizations to fight the creeping gentrification of border neighborhoods. Each station is designed, funded, built, programmed, and maintained collaboratively between the campus and the community. And finally, we reject conventional strategies of urban beautification and innovation that turn our public spaces into sites of leisure and consumption. We question the agendas of the creative class and their pop-ups, which too often really just accelerate gentrification, and they appropriate arts and culture for private ends. Really, they become an apology for the absence of more substantial public investment in the city. We believe public space must become civicized, to use James Tully's beautiful concept, a site of dialogue and contestation, and infused with resources and tools to increase public knowledge and community capacity for political and environmental action. So now, a tour of the UCSD community stations and just a hint about what goes on in these spaces.
For us, urban justice is a distributed concept, requiring not only the redistribution of resources, but also the redistribution of knowledges. We designed this reciprocal knowledge infrastructure as both a collaborative education platform, but also a model for shared urban intervention. We claimed that the economic and programmatic power of our public university can be leveraged for communities to develop their own public spaces and social housing. As a distributed system of public spaces transgressing the wall, the community stations specialize social justice, mobilizing cross-border citizenship culture through cultural action. With our community partners, we have co-developed 4 community stations, 2 in San Diego, 2 in Tijuana. So let's move north from north to south. The UCSD Earth Lab Community Station is a partnership with Groundwork San Diego, an environmental justice nonprofit, located in the low-income, primarily Black and Latinx neighborhood of Encanto, a community characterized by high unemployment, low educational attainment, food insecurity, and cyclical poverty. The station occupies a 4-acre vacant parcel owned by the San Diego Unified School District, who granted the parcel to our partnership to increase educational capacity for the 8 public schools within walking distance of the site. The goal was to promote circulations between traditional classroom-based learning and outdoor experiential learning. This access to municipal land gave us leverage to assemble a unique cross-sector collaboration between a major research university, a local school district, and a grassroots organization to co-develop public space, placing education at the center of community development. Before COVID-19 hit, 3,000 kids and their families circulated through the Earth Lab each year. And during the current transition, it continues to operate as an outdoor, socially distanced classroom. Recently, the school district committed capital monies towards a more refined physical resolution of the site for what has been so far a largely informal effort, while UCSD, our university, will invest in sustainable educational programming, research, and management in collaboration with Groundwork San Diego, the grassroots organization, who will steward community participation. Pedagogic zones at the site will be focused on habitat restoration through energy, water, food, and community programs, all wrapped by indigenous Kumeyaay knowledges and environmental practices. Ultimately, the UCSD Earth Lab Community Station will perform as an open-air climate action park designed for environmental education and climate justice. The district has also committed school bond funding for a new climate action design building to anchor the site and as a pilot for post-COVID porosity in classroom design. this station will break ground in 2022. Moving south, the UCSD Casa Community Station is a partnership with the nonprofit Casa Familiar, a 30-year-old community-based social service organization. It is located in the border neighborhood of San Isidro, site of the busiest land crossing in the Western Hemisphere. The community is 90% Latinx and has one of the highest unemployment rates, lowest median household income, and worst air quality in San Diego County. The heart of this community station is a beloved historic church that sat for decades in disrepair and which we were able to rescue through this project with our partners. During construction, the building had to be lifted for installing new foundations. During times of so much political violence in our region inflicted on our community, the surreal image of the church levitating with Tijuana's informal settlements in the distance inspired a sense of hope for the local residents. With the adaptive reuse of this historic building as catalyst, we designed the UCSD Casa Community Station as a double project, a parcel-sized social infrastructure made of spaces for cultural and economic activity is flanked by affordable housing. The organizational design of the parcel as a system of linear stripes with a variety of small-scale buildings performing different roles was also a deliberate strategy to mobilize diverse financial streams to fund the different building typologies. Leveraging programmatic investments by the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation to support the educational, cultural, and research programming between the university and the community, Casa Familiar, our partners, and UCSD secured capital investments by the Park Foundation and Art Place America to build the social service infrastructure. These investments, in turn, enabled Casa Familiar to qualify for a $9 million new market tax credits development package facilitated by the local municipality. Casa Familiar has become now an alternative developer of affordable housing for its own community of San Isidro, and public space was the detonator. We renovated the historic church into a community theater with an outdoor stage. This performance space is flanked on one side by a series of small accessory buildings for Casa Familiar social programming, and on the other side by an open-air civic classroom pavilion. This social, educational, and cultural infrastructure anchors 10 units of affordable housing at both ends of the parcel, all mediated by pedestrian walkways. We never imagined that this choreography of indoor and outdoor spaces would become a community asset during a global pandemic. Ultimately, the project advances a reproducible prototype for small-scale development in low-income neighborhoods where buildings collaborate to transform small lots into social housing infrastructures. We completed construction of this station in February, just before COVID-19 hit and the residents moved in. It's all locked down now, but it is a site built for social proximity, and we cannot wait to return in person. Affordable housing takes on a different meaning when it is deliberately threaded into spaces for social programming, summoning residents to participate in the development of local economy and cultural production, synergizing spaces, programs, resources, and people. This is an integrated socio-spatial system that is programmed between our university and the community. So let's imagine a small coalition of local artists, promotoras, activists, and neighborhood youth collaborating with university curators, theater script writers, and visual artists who come together periodically to co-produce a play that explores an urgent issue facing the community, enacted by local youth in the community theater. These artistic productions are rooted in neighborhood stories and become bottom-up evidentiary material to increase public knowledge and public policy transformation. Before moving across the border, allow me to pause for a moment to summarize a couple of concepts and share how these processes behind our two San Diego-based stations exemplify several core commitments, or as we call them, building blocks in our practice. In conditions of poverty, housing needs to be embedded in an infrastructure of social, economic, and cultural support. In other words, we must rethink affordable housing from autonomous units into relational social systems. Housing is public infrastructure. Density should not be measured as an abstract number of objects or people per area. Density must be understood instead as the intensity of social and economic exchanges per area. Migrant neighborhoods have taught us that these exchanges, mobilized by bottom-up urbanization, is the DNA for democratizing the city into more inclusive and plural environments. Zoning must stop being punitive, preventing socialization. Instead, it should be conceptualized as a generative tool that anticipates, stimulates, and organizes social and economic activity in neighborhoods. The developer's proforma is architectural financial plastic. Inside the mathematics of this spreadsheet, our services as architects amounts to 15% of a project's construction costs. This undercapitalized asset can in fact be mobilized as collateral for development. Nothing should prevent us architects from becoming developers of our own projects, and by association, nothing should prevent communities from doing the same. The sweat equity of architects, cultural producers, and community leaders, the economic equity of public universities, and municipal protocols for accessing public parcels can be bundled, aggregated, to enable communities to develop their own neighborhoods. That's really what has been our story. Moving across the border, our two community stations in Tijuana are located in the Laureles Canyon, an informal settlement adjacent to the border wall. I will take a few moments to describe this incredible context. This location is at an important juncture of conflict. Here, the topography of Tijuana's canyons clash with the border wall before spilling northbound into an environmentally protected estuary in San Diego, now layered with security infrastructure. At this hotspot, the conflict between natural and jurisdictional systems and between ecological and political priorities is profound. As we zoom in further, we witness a collision between the estuary in the US, the border wall, and the informality of the Laureles Canyon, which is home to 92,000 people. This aerial video shows Laureles Canyon, this is where we work, and the precarious condition of the informal settlement that has sprawled on the slopes. This site sits 30 minutes away from our campus and demonstrates the dramatic proximity of wealth and extreme poverty in our region. Laureles Canyon is impacted by dump sites, drastic erosion, flooding, and landslides, and all of this is exacerbated by the dramatic precipitation fluctuations of climate change. Because Laureles Canyon lacks water and waste management infrastructure to mitigate these impacts, much of the trash, along with tons of sediment, flows upstream, ending in the estuary in San Diego, contaminating this bi-regional and shared bi-national asset. Here, the border wall is in fact an artifact of environmental insecurity. These impacts have intensified in recent years because of a profound lack of collaboration between San Diego and Tijuana to manage these cross-border flows. In the last decades, 70% of the open lands in Laureles Canyon has been lost to irregular urban growth. We have been researching and identifying and bundling on squatted lands in the settlement that are still environmentally rescuable to shape an archipelago of conservation. We have been advancing an ambitious regional project called the Cross-Border Commons, an environmental conservation initiative that links the estuary in the US with the informal settlement in Mexico, forming a continuous social and ecological envelope that transgresses the wall and protects the environmental systems shared between these two border cities. With our Tijuana-based activist partners, we are curating a coalition of state and municipal agencies, grassroots organizations, and universities on both sides of the wall. And we are now negotiating with the municipality in Tijuana to gain access to the remaining public lands inside the informal settlement. Another important contextual note before I introduce the Tijuana stations is that the Laureles Canyon, this informal settlement, has also been the site where we have advanced our research on informal urbanization. As we have written about over many years, the informal settlements of Tijuana are built with urban waste from San Diego, recycling architectural parts to construct habitation and infrastructure. We have learned a great deal, obviously, from these incremental building practices as people construct their own shelter in layers over time. In a case study we documented before, a metal frame appeared one day from to another. In a couple of months, recycled materials begin to thread the spaces. And in the next weeks, an informal house emerges. We have also taken note that multinational maquiladoras or factories surrounding these informal settlements typically benefit from easy access to cheap labor. Over the years, we have experimented with factory-made material systems to structurally mediate the recycling of waste. Because Tijuana is a city of multinational factories that prey on cheap labor, we have proposed an ethical loop where factories invest and should invest in emergency housing. Here, we are inside Mecalux, a Spanish maquiladora that produces lightweight metal shelving system for global export, adapting its prefabricated systems. Here we are negotiating with them to adapt their systems into structural scaffolds as armatures for informal housing. We designed a catalog with the factory's engineers to test a variety of prototypes and configurations. The first Mecalux typology is shown here with adapted recycled urban waste from San Diego, illustrating something that is essential to our practice of mediation, really, how to facilitate the linkage of top-down institutional resources to support the bottom-up creative intelligence of informal urbanization. A couple of years ago, we built the first example. To tell the truth, being inside this factory, redirecting its material systems and its surplus value to sites of emergency was an important milestone in our research-based practice. We then worked with our partners in the community to build early applications to demonstrate the adaptability of the system, such as this small bus stop to shelter Laureles workers from the sun. It was important to introduce you briefly to these contextual processes because our two community stations in Tijuana operate within this rich ecology of social, environmental, economic, and material relations and partnerships. Now, let's move to the stations themselves. The UCSD Alacran community station here is located in the most rugged, precarious, and polluted sub-basin of the canyon. It is a partnership with Embajadores de Jesus, a religious organization led by activist pastor economist Gustavo Banda Aceves and pastor psychologist Zaida Guillen. With limited resources, they began construction of a refugee camp to provide shelter, food, and basic services to hundreds of Haitian and Central American refugees while they navigate unjust asylum processes in the US and Mexico. And with the help of skilled migrants, they began building their own emergency housing. We have established a long-term partnership to co-develop with them a community station here to increase refugee housing capacity. We are now accelerating production of the Mecalux frames to install them on vernacular post and beam concrete systems into a housing infrastructure. The housing scaffolds will be built first, leaving the interiors as planned open systems equipped with utilities to support incremental live-work configurations. These envelopes are the seeds for an evolving sanctuary neighborhood to be infilled through time by the immigrants, residents themselves. We see migrant housing as a mechanism for generating jobs. To sustain the construction process over time, we have designed a sanctuary economy. We embed refugee housing in spaces of fabrication, training, small-scale economic development. With the support of the Park Foundation, we have assembled a community-owned business, the Little Haiti Construction Cooperative, with a tool library, wood and metal machines, and a couple of trucks and tractors. They will complete, our partners, will complete construction of the site and remain operational for future construction jobs across the informal settlement. The UCSD Alacran Community Station began construction last summer with seed capital provided by New York-based philanthropists Robert Rubin and Stefan Samuel, whose collaboration on this project expands their commitments to the prefabricated social housing logics of post-war French architect Jean Prouvé. And finally, our UCSD Community Station. This station is a partnership with Colonos de la Divina Providencia, a Tijuana NGO that is rooted in the community of Divina. The nonprofit facilitates a variety of social services, including meals for youth, senior services, medical assistance, and environmental awareness. Using the Mecalux parts, the station takes the shape of a flexible scaffold to accommodate a variety of informal programs, including flea markets, cultural events, and a series of multi-level spaces to accommodate a small high school, all curated between our university and our partners. At the Divina Station, we work with community leaders, students, and researchers on social protection from landslides, floods, and estuary health beyond the wall. We lead educational programming through which young people understand zones of vulnerability in their own neighborhoods, emphasizing ecological conservation of species and habitat restoration. It's really never too early to begin. We have committed to elevating children here as the cross-border citizens of the future. Our two Tijuana-based stations have also advanced important building blocks for our practice, two in particular. For us, the informal is not just an aesthetic category. The informal for us is a praxis, a dynamic set of functional urban operations from below that counter and transgress the imposition of top-down political power and exclusionary economic models. Hospitality is the first gesture when the immigrant arrives, an essential charitable opening, a first step in creating a more welcoming society. But as needs become more complex over time, charity is not the appropriate model for building an inclusive society. We need to move from hospitality to inclusion. Thinking beyond shelter is the foundation for rethinking refugee camps everywhere, from places of short-term habitation and service provision to durable infrastructures for inclusion. Migrant shelters can be agile for negotiating both transition and rootedness, the ephemeral and the permanent.
So these are the four UCSD community stations. There's so much more to say about them and about our amazing partners and what we do together in these spaces. While the stations all focus on different issues reflecting the priorities of each community, they are all richly curated for dialogue, collaborative research, urban pedagogy, participatory design build, and cultural production. They all aspire to increase public knowledge, challenge divisive political narratives, foster solidarity and collective agency, and advance strategies to counter exploitation, dispossession, deportation, and environmental calamity. These activities often invite encounters with formal institutions of power that govern the borders zone. And sometimes, you know, these meetings facilitate mutual recognition and cooperation, and sometimes they don't. For us, the goal is less about resolving conflict than about understanding, recognizing, and democratizing it. We see democracy in the border zone as a fundamentally bottom-up process of exposing and rendering more accessible the complex histories and mechanisms of injustice that are too often hidden, really, behind official accounts of who we are. Racist political narratives in the United States portray the border as a site of rupture and criminality, but we've been committed to generating, you know, different stories, counter narratives about life in this region that are grounded, right, in the experience of those who inhabit it. We are, as I said, we're a region of flows and circulation, shared practices and aspirations, alliances of hearts and minds, regardless of the wall that restricts the movements of our bodies. In this sense, the community stations really become a cross-border observatory, a kind of platform for constructing what we think of as a more elastic civic identity from the bottom up, a kind of cross-border res publica. With our partners, we curate unwalling experiments, right, that dissolve the wall, using visual tools like diagrams and radical cartographies to situate border neighborhoods within broader spatial ecologies of circulation and interdependence, from local to regional to continental and ultimately to global scales. We see elasticity as a kind of civic skill, the ability to stretch and return between local and more expansive ways of thinking over and again, to understand one's challenges within broader dynamics and processes, and to envision opportunities for solidarity and collective action across walls. Here at the border, the idea of a bioregion that Teddy introduced earlier, the binational watershed system, has really been a powerful imaginary for activating this more elastic civic thinking. Several years ago, we curated a cross-border public action through one of the sewage drains that Homeland Security had carved into the wall between the Laureles Canyon and the Tijuana River estuary that Teddy introduced to you. We negotiated a permit with U.S. Homeland Security to transform this drain into an official port of entry southbound for 24 hours. They agreed. They were disarmed by our self-presentation as just artists, as long as Mexican immigration officials were waiting on the other side to stamp our passports. Our convoy was comprised of 300 local activists, residents, representatives from the municipalities of San Diego and Tijuana, and artists and border activists from around the world. We summoned agencies who are typically at odds with one another. And as we moved together southbound underneath the wall, we witnessed slum wastewater, right, flowing northbound toward the estuary beneath our feet. This strange crossing from estuary to slum through a militarized culvert and the stamping of passports inside of this space amplified the most profound interdependencies of our border region. The great insight here was that protecting the vulnerable U.S. estuary demands shared investment in the informal Mexican settlement. So in this cultural event, we went down, right? But sometimes nurturing civic elasticity requires ascending above the familiar. In the early 20th century, Patrick Geddes designed the Camera Obscura in the center of Edinburgh, a five-story observation tower that enabled people to look out across the region and comprehend the environmental systems that organize it. He coined the term regionalism. For Geddes, this was essential for constructing a civic identity and collective political will. Now, imagine a Mexican child standing on a narrow sliver of land above the Laureles Canyon, hundreds of feet above the border wall, right here, at a place called Mirador. Imagine she plants her feet facing due west with the vast blue expanse of the Pacific Ocean in front of her, Mexico to her left and the US to her right. Below to her immediate left, she sees the dense informal settlement where she lives. She can spot her house, her school, and experience their proximity to a country that she and her family are not allowed to enter. Below to her immediate right, almost directly beneath her feet, she sees the border wall, which, you know, from this vantage looks like a flimsy and ridiculous strip inserted onto a vast and powerful natural system. Lifting her eyes a bit, She sees the green expanse of the Tijuana River estuary with its vulnerable wetland habitats and sediment basins that were contrived to catch the northbound flows of trash from her community. And further beyond still, you can't see it in this image, downtown San Diego rising vertically into the sky. From this vantage, all the characters of this contested zone come to life. We've witnessed this moment of recognition again and again over the years among children, our students, policymakers, and even foundation presidents. There are a few places on earth, we would argue, where the collision of informality, militarization, environmental insecurity, and the proximity of wealth and poverty can be so vividly experienced. But in reality, the conflicts that we experience here locally between nation and nature are reproduced again and again along the entire trajectory of the continental border between the United States and Mexico. Over the years, we've collected aerial photos like these that document precise moments when the jurisdiction collides with natural systems, powerfully illustrating what dumb sovereignty looks like when it hits the ground in a complex bioregion. Our Mexus project stretches our elastic civic aspirations to a continental scale. Mexus visualizes the entire border zone without the line. It dissolves the border into a bioregion whose shape is defined by the eight binational watershed systems bisected by the international border. Mexus also exposes other systems and flows across this bioregional territory: tribal nations, protected lands, croplands, urban crossings, many more informal ones, 15 million people, and much more. Ultimately, Mexus counters America's wall-building fantasies with more expansive imaginaries of belonging and cooperation beyond the nation state. Here the project is in 2018 at the Venice Architecture Biennale. In Community Stations programming, Mexus becomes a provocation for dialogues about a shared bioregional civic identity among Mexicans, Americans, and diverse tribal nations who inhabit this contested space. Now, the final civic stretch, literally, is a visualization project called the Political Equator, which traces an imaginary line from the San Diego-Tijuana border across the planet, forming a corridor of global conflict between the 30 and 38 degrees north. Along its trajectory lie some of the world's most contested and violent thresholds: the US-Mexico border at San Diego-Tijuana, the Strait of Gibraltar and the Mediterranean, the sort of main route from North Africa into Fortress Europe, the Israeli-Palestinian border that divides the Middle East, emblematized by Israel's 50-year military occupation of the West Bank and Gaza, India-Kashmir, a site of intense and enduring territorial conflict between Pakistan and India, the border between North and South Korea, representing decades of intractable Cold War conflict, and China's accelerating militarization of the South China Sea. Now, visualizing this political equator alongside the climatic equator below in green was an astonishing discovery for us, because the ribbon between them, sort of give and take a few degrees, contains our planet's most populous slums, its sites of greatest natural resource extraction and export, and its zones of greatest political instability, climate vulnerability, and human displacement. And when these, you know, parallel equators are applied to the Pierce quincuncial projection, you know, from above, the Arctic becomes protagonist with its melting ice caps, detonating hemispheric conflicts through sea level rise, dramatic coastal vulnerability, and human displacement. Really, in the end, the collision of nationalism and borders, climate catastrophe, and forced migration is the global justice trifecta of our time. But as we said at the beginning, these dynamics always hit the ground somewhere and are experienced by people locally in everyday places like ours. Thank you.
Wow. Can you hear me, Teddy and Fona?
Yes, I'm.
Amazing,
yes.
Amazing presentation. So eloquently crafted and rigorously shaped, both in terms of kind of unifying the political, ethical, entrepreneurial design, environmental agenda. It's a tour de force as a presentation, and incredibly aspirational. I certainly have a number of questions, and I have no doubt that my colleagues and the student community will start entering in questions in the chat room. It was like poetry, Fana. A number of phrases stand out. One earlier in the presentation where you were talking about decolonizing knowledge. And my goodness, that's embedded in language, in social practices, in the material embodiment of the built environment. Having to, excuse the term here, kind of deconstruct that apparatus to be able to kind of reshape it in a more ethically sound and responsive way, kind of represents a kind of daunting proposition. So, and I think, you know, this is a bit of a rhetorical question, because the projects that you're engaged in are certainly working towards dismantling that apparatus and providing an alternate vision. But if you could speak more about how that asserts itself as a powerful engine for discriminatory practices. And, you know, I mean, we've just gone through in the last 4 years of the Trump administration, we've actually seen the, sorry to be so partisan here, but a lot of these kinds of ideological agendas manifest in the most overt and profound ways to kind of increase oppression and racism and systemic practices worldwide. I'm if you could talk a little bit more about somehow, again, dismantling the decolonizing knowledge that you're aspiring to, that would be a great start.
Yeah.
Perfect. You want to begin, Fona?
Sure. So look, I mean, we're deeply interested in institutional transformation. And any institution we touch, we immediately look for the cracks and the flaws and how can things be better to support more equitable urbanization. I mean, that's always the sort of standard by which we engage institutions, and our university is no different. I mean, we've really been trying to change university norms from the inside. And, you know, really the first one is to just, you know, tackle this idea that university researchers and designers can understand what they're doing without the voices of the marginalized. And so again, it's about, you know, relinquishing these assumptions that we can solve the world's problems, and demanding that the voices of communities enter into the way universities educate and the way they do research. what we've witnessed, particularly over the last, I mean, there, you know, we live in a region where there's a lot of human pain. I mean, all of these like crazy policy decisions by the last administration had a real human toll on our community partners. And it was important that those voices come into the research that we're doing. We couldn't possibly understand without them, right? But universities aren't set up to do that. They're not set up to work that way. And so what we're doing, what we're trying to do, is to train an entire generation of students who come through our programming how to ethically engage communities and listen and listen to their stories and integrate those stories into the way we then approach research and design.
Yes, and you know, I can expand a bit on that, because obviously there are a variety of maybe procedures, let's say, for a moment, or spaces also of operation when we speak of decolonization in this case. On one hand, you know, I can mention we work in this very contested geography where indigenous histories and traditions and, you know, have been so present, but always forgotten and invisible always to the institutions. So through our work with the leadership, let's say, of many of these local tribes, we've been opening up really new methods of education. Obviously, a lot of what is of interest here is ultimately something that also should inspire us as architects, you know, the idea of revitalizing our own language, right, and our own methods, retooling ourselves. And often when we teach courses in the university, but when we sometimes do with our students of architecture, we always begin by saying, you know, our own practices is the first site of intervention in decolonizing the cliches and the types of agendas that really have perpetuated a variety of very faulty kind of methods of intervention. So yes, it is to think through other epistemologies, but through the methods, in what is the praxis, what are the procedures that are inscribed in those epistemologies. That has been of incredible interest, by the way, to our partners in the Kumeyaay tribes here, because as you can imagine, many artists, and often artists, architects who rely a lot on the metaphorical power of images, we tend to translate simply the metaphorical fixity of those methods and those procedures, instead of really learning from the more dynamic systems that really are embedded, whether in oral histories and eventually in actual practices in terms of everyday life. Now, that's just a whole area, let's say, the revitalization of language. The other one is really about knowledge exchanges. So is what Fona was mentioning. We have gotten support, for example, to give stipends. I mean, one thing that we must say is that we believe that our engagement with communities is not just about volunteerism, that they need to be also remunerated because of their time and their commitment. And so we have programs that enable activists to come to the university, obviously, to teach with us, but to help us reorganize our research and educational agendas. But in that process, there is also a procedural kind of also interesting system where the knowledges meet. There is maybe not too much time to talk about this, but we are not necessarily designers who belong to the tradition of community-based design, or we just go to communities to, you know, just to take notes and then go back to the office and design something that was literally asked of us. We really enjoy the kind of more contested relation where our knowledges meet. We as architects have something to contribute from the beginning in conceptualizing and producing forms of imagination as well that can match and meet communities' hopes in everyday practices. So all I'm trying to say is that decolonizing also is about reverting and reorganizing the hierarchies that have been misunderstood between communities.
It's not about reversing the hierarchy so that the community is on top and the researcher and designers on the bottom. It's truly about a horizontal meeting. And, you know, so we've gotten into trouble sometimes with our more sort of anthropologically minded colleagues who believe deeply in community self-determination. Sometimes when communities have been inured to poverty and deprivation for a long time, they don't know the horizons of opportunity. So coming into a community, you know, we're all bringing things So we've been committed to that idea.
And finally, maybe one more aspect here, which is important for our practice, is a more curatorial and translational aspect of these knowledge exchanges. So a lot of our work has been really researching, as we discussed, the power, the amazing energy of these bottom-up urban dynamics that are off the radar. And all of that intelligence on the ground, which really for us is the DNA to reimagine the city in more equitable ways, needs political representation. And we facilitate maybe that knowledge to knock on the doors of the institutions to transform top-down policy. So that journey from the bottom up to the top down and back with resources is also another maybe form of the colonization, let's say, in the relationship between institutions and publics. And finally, I think, because this is all about exchanges and transferences and meeting and all this, it is about the demystifying what we call interdisciplinarity, which in our university, I know in yours, but it's like, is reduced to this very naive idea that we can just gather around a round table where we just offer our point of view from our own silos. And just because we're in one room, we are already working in interdisciplinarily. We have been arguing that we need to contaminate with each other's methods and procedures. So when we are talking about stealing the knowledge of the developer, to really think of transferring that knowledge to communities, that's another aspect, I think, of the colonization that is fundamental here, because at the end of the day, it's about redistributing resources and knowledges, as we said. I think that that is more or less, I mean, it's very complicated. The colonizing in this case is to really obviously harvest or dig almost archaeologically, you know, to infiltrate into a variety of paradigms that really have been faulty and have been ultimately producing so much exclusion and marginalization across many registers. So these are, for us, knowledge in the democratizing of knowledge, not only in terms of research and education is fundamental, but also in terms of the tools, to accessing the tools to develop the city with others.
Is it fair to say that this lateral strategy of engagement, where there's no hierarchy, and the kind of antiquated model of the architect, and I think Fona spoke to this, or maybe Teddy as well, where in the past there was a kind of unspoken assumption that we know a little bit about everything, and in our kind of monastery and elite space, we can actually serve as the chief curator. Your new model requires an incredibly sophisticated balancing act, because you are, and you speak to this in greater detail, there are certain moments in time within the collaboration where the contributor is given the podium, the microphone, and their voice is of great value. But as we all know, there has to be some synthesis that unifies and solidifies, concretizes sets of decisions so that theory can move into practice. Can you speak in greater detail about those complexities that are not necessarily revealed in your presentation, because you're trying to foreground the kind of democratic aspirational goal here. Yet behind the scenes, there must be some wonderfully complex dynamics.
So, you know, the answer from our end to that question, it's all about trust. I mean, the projects have taken a long time because there was a long process of building trust and mutual understanding through sometimes rough patches. Because, you know, communities are dealing with the struggles of every day, and they understand how their communities work, and they've been fed sometimes a lot of BS by unscrupulous sort of partnerships between municipalities and private developers who are selling them a bill of goods for their neighborhood. And so we're struggling against all of these dynamics, and we deeply believe that, you know, we believe in community self-determination, but we also are able from an outside perspective to see some of the biases that exist. So, you know, sometimes there are rough patches. And I think, you know, finding sort of harmony and moving forward from those rough patches over time builds trust. so that you can have open and contested conversation and come up with solutions to design challenges and opportunities opportunities that come up. Maybe you could talk about the some of the challenges in San Ysidro, Teddy.
Yes, no, I mean, I'm thinking about the question in terms of a variety of instances. And we believe, by the way, we've been thinking a lot about this, traditionally notions of the historic avant-garde, as you remember, have depended on critical distance, right? We, from the institutions, and we've been arguing again, as we mentioned in the talk, about a critical proximity that really pushes us to infiltrate, to enter the institutions, to negotiate. A more agonistic dimension of, you know, exposing the hegemony of such institutional dominance in its paradigms and its methods. So conversations with our own chancellor, where he finally understood that education could be central to economic development, accessing higher education, a variety of other, to maybe the negotiation with a factory owner who understood and never imagined the adaptation of the systems could really be redirected. In other words, the kinds of entities that might we think that might be the enemy might be willing to negotiate for a moment, and we in creating a more, you know, solidaristic approach. I don't want to paint a rosy picture here. All I'm trying to say is that we depend at this very moment, primarily in a time of polarization and division, on new types of protocols. We argue often that designers should be designing only things, but the civic, economic, and political processes, the protocols themselves to assure inclusion in this type of more egalitarian dimension. And then the other stories are more about a community scale, you know, where we've been fighting and challenging the kind of packaging of identity and the kind of politics of identity through style, right? I mean, this is one of the most memorable workshops that we co-produced with our partners in San Ysidro was when we said, yeah, hey guys, let's not think of how these buildings will look like Aztec pyramids, or will be painted a purple like Luis Barragán in a good way. Let's suspend here our good friend Stan Allen always inspired us, obviously, in thinking that as architects we were just obsessed with the way things look instead of understanding how buildings, what they do, how they perform. And so our workshops were oriented to raising awareness in a very contested way, by the way. It was like push and pull. The recognition of the negotiation of boundaries in the neighborhood where people were building non-conforming granny flats already years ago to sustain an extended family, or plugging an informal economy in a garage, or encroaching into the right of way temporarily for a small informal. All of those negotiations with resources, boundaries, people, let's say, those solidaristic practices, empathy, local forms of governance, collaboration, all of those things amounted to a more dynamic, performative interpretation of identity. And that began to shift the discussion to the degree that some people in the community workshop began to realize that their houses were selfish in terms of ubiquitous, let's say, American style suburban planning, individual houses on individual lots. And then nothing should prevent them from negotiating the boundaries and beginning to create a maybe alternative land use. This is where we began to extract our notion of density needing to really be measured through the intensity of exchange and activity. So in other words, these are might be naive for many people, but this began to construct and help us to construct a new political language, as we call it, but not on our own. It depended, it emerged from those contested and sort of series of exchanges. So, and there are many other instances of these kinds of things.
No, there's some. It's fascinating. I mean, it's almost as though you're creating a new curriculum, and that curriculum, with respect to educating the next generation of global citizens, requires that there is you're able to blur the boundary between a variety of institutional entities and responding or kind of underscoring the comment about trust, based on the fact that it's mutually beneficial that they share this knowledge and that they move into this unfamiliar territory, which at first can not only be awkward, but rather problematic and anxious. And I'm reminded of one of the community stations where you spoke about the industrial partner who manufactures lightweight metal shelving. And in recognition, and maybe you could speak more to this, of the benefit of redirecting that technological expertise in an area to empower the community, that ethical loop constitutes a return where profit is distributed on some level, right? Mm-hmm. There's some kind of economic prosperity that moves from the bottom up and top down. So everyone wins. Mm-hmm. That's a pretty sophisticated proposition. And it's a big, I would imagine, a big leap for a number of industries. I'm reminded of the difficulty that this country has had overcoming the propaganda around climate change, the deniers. Yeah. And the difficulty to move forcefully into the 21st century with sustainable technologies. I mean, it's probably a combination of messaging and propaganda and diplomacy and an extremely skillful and savvy strategy on your part. I'm just saying there's a kind of case study with what you guys are able to achieve that could extend out and address a lot of problems that this country and nations are facing around the world.
I mean, so this convergence of private and public interests has always really interested us. I mean, obviously, there's a whole there's a whole literature on corporate responsibility and why corporations get involved in projects that aren't immediately beneficial to their bottom line. We were very fortunate to find a CEO who was receptive to what we were attempting to do in Tijuana. But for every one that you find, like we found, there are 1,000 who really don't care. I remember we were sitting around a table and presenting our ideas to the CEO of the Mekolux factory, just a lovely human being. And a light went off in his head. And he said, we were explaining, that we were actually trying to figure out how to repurpose his materials for social housing. And a light went off in his head. He said, I understand. He said, humanitarianism. And I'm like, yes, very good. So, whatever works with whoever you're speaking with. But I think what you brought up, Evan, is the need to modulate and adapt the message to the audience that you're speaking with. Most corporate CEOs get involved in sort of ethical projects or humanitarian projects because they have an entire like area on their website where they can talk about it and promote it and show the sort of the humane face of their corporate practices. But this really wasn't this particular CEO's agenda. I think he was genuinely moved by the idea that this corporation could give something back to the community that was providing their labor. I mean, what we've discovered in doing this work over time is there's a segment of the population who will be motivated by genuine public collective imperatives, right? But the majority of the population needs reasons. And it's been important to us to find what those reasons are. And let me give you one example of this. you know, we've been working for years to try to create collaboration around environmental stressors in the border region. And it wasn't until San Diegans really began to understand that their future is intertwined with Tijuana, and that if we don't work together, all of that waste is going to come up San Diego's coasts and pollute our beaches and kill our fish and everything, then they start getting involved. So it was an interest-based reason that brought what looks like an ultimately cooperative and ethical and collaborative kind of sensibility. But you're right, it's about finding the key to turn people. And by the way, climate change is exactly the same way. Once people start understanding that they're going to be impacted by this, it's amazing how quickly their attitudes about this thing change.
It's still a very abstract idea. And anything that operates, well, I'm exaggerating the point, on geologic time, it doesn't have an immediate impact on them or their children tomorrow, not next week and not 5-10 years from now. It doesn't constitute a danger. It's not an existential risk. And I think part of the challenges are around climate change is because it's so massive and it's so abstract, and it's not messaged in such a way that they understand how it constitutes a threat to their individual survival and status in life. I don't know. I mean, so I'm when you spoke about having to modify language in relation to your audience, you're probably masters at that moment, at this point in time, right? Because when you speak to the community, there's probably a whole set of biases that you have to unpack with them. I think Terry was speaking about the iconography of a house and certain assumptions about aesthetic, power, pleasure, autonomy, freedom, that don't necessarily are not, foregrounded as a priority in these architectural projects. On the contrary, it's a little bit more nebulous, and they assume authorship over the aesthetic sensibility of the work, right?
Yeah, can I for a moment just take a point in terms of the first question you asked about what I understand similar to Heather McGee's new book called The Sum of Us, where she argues what she calls the dividends of solidarity. Mm-hmm. Trying to find a way out of, again, it's exactly that what you were saying, like the survival of the individual, you know, depends on the health of the collective. And eventually that we all benefit, obviously. She's trying to find a way out, just like maybe implicitly we are too in the context of, you know, pushing across this message, right, that in this period of huge hatred, misinformation, obviously, and polarization, that we are damaging ourselves, right, that this is the paradigmatic central argument that we have at the border, right, that the destiny of these two cities that are divided is intertwined. And that is not just so an easy thing of just saying rejecting the other, because by rejecting the other, we're damaging our own selves. And there is a lot of evidence, you know, obviously in the kind of the physical violence in terms of the territory, but in a variety of other ways. So yes, new strategies of interdependence, right? This is, and what language enables that to be recognized beyond the ideological big tents and the kinds of, you know, in what ways, again, we stop preaching to the choir, right? How do we learn to talk to those who disagree? And finally, this issue of also dissolving this public-private, for us, inequality has always been about the polarization of public and private interest, unfortunately. But how to enable the community to come into that equation, not as a binary, but as a triad almost, and the benefits through the community. I would say just quickly that it's not to say that the CEO of the factory donated the material. Okay, we negotiated a business plan. He subsidized the material. Yeah. Because what we've been interested in, these informal settlements that build themselves with the waste of San Diego in Tijuana, right? Buildings that they build with recycled stuff because they purchase it. It's not that they find it. There is a political economy of waste at play here that we were entering, within which the factories were an actor. And so we began to kind of create this sort of model of letting, we bought the material from them, but at a very, very like subsidized price, because eventually the simplicity of the system could become an economic model that can be supported by subsidies from the municipality, right? And other kinds of, so we really, that was the foundation of that relationship too. He respected us, not for coming here just to ask for charity, but to really embed his own productive assembly line. Not in through the kind of humanitarian aspect, because he understood, wow, yes, this could really become informal housing for the workers that work here. So anyway, it was much more complex than just going to convince a president of a company to donate.
How long do some of these projects take?
Oh my God.
A long time.
the San Isidro project, which is our first community station, it's a project that we began years ago as a research project with our community partners. And many of these projects, as we were telling you, Evan, right, we are masochistic, because we decided at some point that we didn't want to wait for the client. We wanted to co-produce the client. We wanted to co-produce the brief with the client. And through that, finding ways to really produce a new form of financial, a kind of framework, an economic framework for the project, arguing also changes in zoning. And so the San Isidro project, almost 15 more plus years from its inception, we arrived to a neighborhood
where they were
incredible resources. There was not, it's a project that began with almost nothing in terms of, nothing really in terms of, not even a parcel. And we began to stitch this. And finally, when we, in recent years, we discovered this amazing potential that the university could be a guarantor, but also could leverage with its economic power the kinds of lending or the kinds of access to subsidy and so that the community could become the developer and own that infrastructure. It was just, that's when now it's faster. Now it's a little accelerated.
So there's a, I mean, there are a lot of ways to describe this, but there's an entrepreneurial model here and design, aside from design in the traditional sense, in terms of what things look like, there's an enormous amount of creativity that underlies the organizational structure and the practices that you've had to devise that are both flexible and nuanced to facilitate differences and unexpected responses. Would it be appropriate to say that after all that time, kind of developing this emergent strategy that you're in a position in terms of a more refined body of knowledge that you can move at a quicker speed and have greater impact?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, I would initially, these projects, and they still are, they're very scrappy. I mean, you figure it out as you go. I mean, you know where you want to get with your partners. We've always, you know, we come up with a vision, right? And we agree on it. But it's the process is, it's very emergent. As you said, you used the word emergent. And we really only started getting our heads around how we were able to do things, kind of looking back, like, wow, and documenting it and really starting to really document these processes as case studies for others to emulate. And we do think that they're transferable. We do. But, you know, I think, again, the reason, you know, why they took time is because, as Teddy said, you know, it's not, we were never approached by a client wanting to build anything. I mean, this is the idea of building emerged through understanding what everybody was bringing to the table and the resources we could seek together. And, you know, it was really very emergent. But now that we have four of them, right, we're starting to learn from successes and mistakes from the earlier projects as we're advancing. And by the way, obviously, after you have early successes with very bottom-up emergent projects like this, you build trust in investors who would be willing to, you know, trust you with money again to give it another go. And that's been our case as well.
No, and that's a reason for the students who are maybe listening, or we've always argued that we should be, again, as I said, designers of process. I mean, I think that in reality, some of us, as you know, Evan, I mean, are designers of our own practice, you know, some of us who are dissatisfied with maybe the way certain protocols work in our profession or even institutions. And so for us, you know, for a long time, a lot of our friends said, so when are you going to build? You're just stuck. I said, well, wait, you know, we're building a position.
Right.
We're you know, retooling ourselves. It takes time. And I think that it's not to sound upset about it, because the point is that it's been interesting to now bundle all these resources, political representation, capability to negotiate with institutions. The university obviously was a fantastic platform from which to really achieve all of that. Trust that has been built through years, that takes a long time. And even thinking of how, with our partners, we're constructing the means of productivity so that we could begin to do more housing in that informal settlement. And so, yes, I think that without sounding awfully pretentious, or, you know, I think that it's a good moment for us finally in terms of advancing some of this work into new levels of, you know, execution.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting because I don't know where the two monographs lie at this moment, but it seems to me they represent a form of open source knowledge, and that in response to the comment you received, when are you going to build? Well, you're building ideas, you're building practices, but you're educating the next generation of not only architects, but an interdisciplinary consortium of leaders that should engage in an alternative practice in order to take on the demands, existential demands of the 21st century. So I think it's a profound project that you guys are engaged in, and I'm not surprised to hear it's taken so long to move it forward, and the inheritance seems to migrate from one community station to the next and become more sophisticated over time. I'm going to now share some questions from the audience. And the first one is from Gerardo. Do you see a day when there will be a balance between the politically defined border and the culturally aligned cross-border association?
So the idea of balance is what I'm wondering about here. I mean, you know, borders can exist. I mean, we've been arguing for more intelligent borders, borders that respect, you know, ecological sort of systems that align and make sense. So, I mean, I don't know. I mean, it's a strange question. I mean, you know, what we're looking for is kind of more porosity, and that the border itself, the jurisdictional line, doesn't determine the environmental, social, economic health of the region. And I should say along these lines that it's a strange part of the world because, you know, the business community in San Diego, Tijuana, hates the border as much as the human rights community does, because, you know, it slows down the free movement of goods and services. So sometimes you find strange bedfellows in regions like this. And Teddy and I have found ourselves on the same side of issues with people who we might be very much at odds with living in another part of the country. So I think it's really about creating national borders that are more respectful of the way life actually operates in a region. So in that sense, maybe there's potential, I don't know.
And you know, obviously we rushed through a lot of maybe very important concepts that, you know, would need a lot more deepening, let's say, but yeah. This notion of the cross-border citizen, you know, that emerged from that performance that we did when we crossed the border under that tunnel, was inspired by our collaborations with the former mayor of Bogota, Colombia, Antanas Mockus, with whom we collaborated. Antanas Mockus, I don't know how many of you know of him, but incredible figure in Latin America who revolutionized really what we mean by, well, in this case, citizenship culture. And he presented a challenge to many architects and urbanists, saying that before we transform the city physically, we have to first transform social norms and behaviors and modes of mutuality and reciprocal sort of expectations. We need to nurture a new citizenship culture based on respect for life and human dignity and all of these things. Are very, very interesting. He began to do performances in the city, summoning cultural producers and artists and trying to change hearts and minds to advance the civic project, something that we urgently need in this country at this moment. But he created what he called a citizenship culture survey, which he deployed in many Latin American cities, commissioned by municipalities, so that the municipalities, because of the nature of the survey, which is really idiosyncratic and really powerful, the municipalities would identify zones of vulnerability in public policy so they could understand where to divert resources. And then they would summon cultural producers to work with communities and so on. So he believed very much on community processes. But we invited him to come to the border region with us, because even though he had applied this citizenship culture survey to cities in their own, we invited him to test it in a binational territory that is divided. So two cities. Let's try to find out if there is a sensibility, a kind of idea that beyond the wall, we are actually aware of a kind of, how would I call it, evolving cross-border public that recognizes the shared interests and common values, even in a moment of division, in a place of division. That would be the first point in terms of this question. I mean, in terms of, so it's less tangible as a kind of, it's more about evolving sensibilities to really recognize what is at stake. And then beyond that, I think there are moments, by the way, that were inspirational to our work, like Kevin Lynch, when he came to San Diego, Tijuana, and commissioned by a civic group, and in the 70s, he developed a project that was called Temporary Paradise, with a question mark. It was a vision plan for San Diego. And he's the first one to say, the future of San Diego depends on the future of Tijuana. He discovered Tijuana when he came to San Diego to do this vision plan. And he declared that the canyons that transgress the border, which we obviously show today, and really this study by Kevin Lynch became inspirational for us, that those canyons as a cross-border environmental ecological system should anticipate the density between these two cities. And he's the first one who proposed a binational airport. So if you're going to have the damn wall there, why don't you make it an infrastructure that is shared? Obviously, this is in the 70s when that sounded like an incredibly utopian metabolist project. You have the airport, right, that straddled the border and produce a kind of shared infrastructure. And it was shelved. The project was shelved until recently, a few years ago. A Texan developer saw opportunity in proposing the airport in Tijuana. The airport in Tijuana is against the border wall. Mm-hmm. That's the reason probably Kevin Lynch thought about this. And it became the first international airport in the region because of the maquiladora industry. A lot of Asian factories needed their CEOs to fly to Japan and China first, and in Japan primarily. And so the airport was really an international airport. Anyway, this Texan developer produced a project where he proposed that people could come to the San Diego side of the wall, check in, cross on the bridge, and enter the airport in Tijuana without touching the ground in the city, which would save incredible amount of time. And the two cities collaborated in making it happen. It's called the, what is the name of it, Fona? The cross, the X.
DBX, the cross-border. DBX,
so it's used by everybody that flies. We have taken this flight, we go park our car in San Diego, check in, cross the border on the bridge, and we are in Mexico City in less than 3 hours. So what I'm trying to say is that single-handedly became the only piece of cross-border infrastructure along the entire continental border. So it, even though it was driven by business and by, a private developer, it shows that these two cities could begin to erode, or border cities can begin to erode the wall if they begin to think more infrastructurally about their shared capabilities in obviously advancing a project of collaboration, basically.
You know, Teddy, there appears to be there are two battle fronts. One is literally at the physical border, and you've been dealing with that for years. I get that, but given the time of social media and the kind of rise of propaganda that specifically targets the demonization of the other, much of the narratives of distrust are away from the border, literally. In other words, they're disseminated among the general population worldwide. So in order to acquire the true agency of transformation and the kind of buy-in and trust that you're speaking about, and this is more of an observation, because I commend you guys for everything that you've done to date. It's not a criticism. It's a recognition that this thing is pervasive around the world, and these kind of social media is perpetuating the kind of propaganda that is ultimately kind of counter. It represents the resistance that you're going to have to be able to deal with and resolve. So I'm just,
But, one of the assumptions of our work, and I think what inspires us so much, is that things work differently here than the official narrative about what goes on here. And one of the, and Teddy touched on this a little bit earlier, but we really see ourselves as translators of this bottom-up reality. Mm-hmm. And we've seen our practice very much in a kind of, in terms of almost like a translational way or a mediating way, that this knowledge that's often hidden from public discourse is brought into the open so that people really understand that there's a lot more trust in this region. There is a cross-border civil society in this region that's really very much off the radar of people who don't live here, who don't experience it. I think that in that sense, and by the way, we've been closely collaborating over the years with activist practices, architectural practices, urban practices in border zones across the world, and they report exactly the same thing. And, right. And so I think the world can learn about what actually goes on in places like ours. We can push against those biases and those. It's very hard. No. I mean, it's out of control right now. The nativism and the hatred of migrants and the suspicion and so on. There was this cultural event in California called A Day Without a Mexican. Now, I think it's actually become national. The California's economy just stops. So it's about amplifying what's hidden.
And I try to also connect to Gerardo's, question earlier, and he added it, I just opened for the first time the chat, but he says that to clarify, how can the political border be fuzzied? And this is an interesting thing, because while I mentioned briefly the project of Kevin Lynch, and then eventually this developer, achieving this sort of cross-border infrastructure, obviously this is about accessibility to a particular sector of the population. I mean, we work with people who will never be able to cross the border. They don't have the papers or the documents and et cetera, and they are incredibly poor. But I was just suggesting again that obviously throughout time, there have been moments where the border has been, ultimately maybe reimagined in what other ways, this is probably what Gerardo was talking about. But recently we became impatient. Uh-huh. And now I'm working, we're working collaboratively in our partnership with Forna, who is a political theorist, who keeps me in shape, whenever I dream as an architect. What else can the border be? You know, how can we fuzzy it? And then said, no, the border should not, you know, we should not be endorsing any, you know, it's like, we were approached by the Third Mind Foundation before Trump took over 4 years ago to see if we wanted to be part of a jury for an international competition they wanted to, you know, sponsor to design the wall, to redesign the wall, right? Because Trump kept saying a more beautiful wall, et cetera. And we rejected the offer, obviously, but what really scared us is that the curators in their brief said, just we want to make sure we remain politically neutral about this, right? And so we realized that was precisely the problem with many design fields, that to remain neutral and impartial in the context of today's crisis and violence is to be complicit, right? that about what has been ethically and morally wrong, right? And that we needed to take a position that xenophobia is wrong, that building border walls is wrong, and that we didn't want to touch it. We didn't want to celebrate it, even if it could be a wonderful performance or insertion into it. So we took our stand, and I think that that's the reason we're working inland, you know, and through these more less tangible systems of consciousness and public thinking. But at the same time, deep inside, I also agree with Kevin Lynch. And I agree that if this is a reality, you know, can this be brought back to the level of infrastructure, land management, resource management, a variety of issues that we cannot ignore? And I think that might get to what Gerardo was saying without suggesting that we just want to camouflage the wall or fuzzy it, but to really shift the paradigm, because border regions everywhere should be laboratories for thinking about interdependence through infrastructural thinking.
And by fuzzier, you know, the idea that the border could somehow become less intolerable or, you know, less ugly, less an obstruction. I don't know, I guess, I mean, Teddy and I typically agree on this. I think he might be more experimental than I am. But, I think that the border should remain an ugly steel fence. I'm really taken by Michael Kimmelman's series on whether architects should be involved in designing prisons and death chambers.
Yeah.
I'm kind of inspired by that, as well as, you know, the literature that's been done on the design firms that were putting in bids for Hitler's crematoria. I mean, I think there are certain areas that, you know, designers and architects just shouldn't go, knowing when not to build, right?
About building a practice. It's
knowing where
not to build and for whom and why, you know?
Yeah.
But also making known that you refuse to participate and for the following reasons.
Yeah.
Right, your name is on it, but it's a sign of protest. Here's another question. This is from Teresa. Thank you for such a compelling lecture. I'm so taken by the beautiful iconography of place that you present in your work. Do you feel there is a way forward for architectural design in the built environment to take on this iconography of community, people, and geography? And what advice would you give for such an application?
I can just think of maybe what ultimately motivated us is to embed ourselves, to be embedded, to be there, to produce a process of communication and presence and continuity. And, you know, and through that, you begin to see what you didn't see, to notice what is unnoticeable, not only to our eyes as designers, but really in terms of the institutions. And so there is potential. This incredibly almost limitless potential, and to realize that we couldn't do it alone, that to be an architect here in a research-based practice, we needed to do it together with others and again, co-producing these types of agendas. And obviously visualization has been an incredibly important political tool. We didn't show many of these experiments about land use across the border how images became incredible mediatory tools to talk to politicians and to translate community desires. So it's not about decorating the problem, it's about finding new types of organizational systems through visuality mm-hmm. that can really rally new constituencies, right? And represent, that's the reason I think that what we need here is a new role of architects as political representatives of what is invisible. Mm-hmm. And I think that that carries with it a variety of responsibilities, which are all, by the way, they are very poetic too. Okay, I'm not suggesting this is all about this more rudimentary technocratic approach. We don't want to polarize aesthetics from politics. In fact, that's a reason for us it's important to really communicate in this way through the images. So yes, yeah, so beautiful question. I think that that has emerged as part of our practice.
But Teddy, I would, maybe I interpret it in a slightly different way. You have this kind of paradoxical stance where there's a theater of operations that promises a kind of infinite change and the anticipation of the fact that the architecture and the community that inhabits it will evolve. And to the extent that the architecture is flexible enough, it will be able to receive the imprint of that change, while at the same time, there are certain design decisions, whether they're specific to the structural system or to certain spatial planning strategies that acknowledge the vernacular and certain kinds of social codes.
Oh, yes.
Place. I mean, it's a very complex and sophisticated balance, because authorship is shared, and yet your, and I'm using this metaphorically, your hand is still present. The education yeah. of an architect has provided you with both the kind of broad skill sets, but the kind of critical thinking and nuancing that's required to kind of recalibrate when you're dealing with these unique spaces and areas of destination, right?
Yes. No, thank you for elaborating on that. Yes. I kept thinking also that we are also part of a lineage, I guess, all of us. I mean, I get super inspired when I think of Constance, you know, dreams of the city being an open scaffold that could organize social and economic relations and the evolutionary patterns, right, of everyday life and so on. And so very utopian thing. I mean, but this is still in our hearts, you know, and whenever we approach these projects, we think of, and obviously, yes, that's the reason we were saying there is something we can offer as architects in this case. But it's also, again, an issue of observation. I mean, when we're working in Tijuana in this context, I mean, the vernacular, right, of the evolutionary patterns through layers, buildings becoming buildings within buildings, the exterior of buildings being resonating the kind of memory of the interior, the vernacular kind of frameworks that really stand for months and then are infilled. All of those are very interesting procedural, again, systems that we began to observe and almost like saying, okay, we found Constant here, right? And so how do we then add a layer? Yes. Or in San Isidro, when a small parcel could yeah. be striated to negotiate interstitial spaces, but also to challenge the minimum parcel size for right. a very suburban city. So yes.
Thank you for that answer. This is from Christiana Bennett, who teaches in the School of Architecture. To me, mapping has historically been generated in order to delineate and assign values in space, i.e., at times created or motivated by a desire to lay claim to one's enemies, in quotes, land, to trace boundaries of us versus them, or to understand other terrains in order to claim as colonies for resource or labor extraction. This deeply rooted problem in terms of the history of use, underlying practices of mapping and cartography. And I wonder if there are limits to the mapping as representation in terms of mexes, watersheds. I wonder if you think mapping water perpetuates ideas of territoriality or of water bodies appearing to delineate territories. So part of me is wondering if mapping needs to go. And at the same time, I see it is still constructive in the overall narrative of visualizing proximities in space that we can't see by eye alone. Apologies for the wordiness. Thank you for your stellar presentation.
I mean, in many ways, it shares similarities with the question that was asked earlier about iconography. I mean, we've, you know, for us, mapping, the kind of radical rethinking of territory has been an essential political tool for rendering, an increasing consciousness about the injustice of borders in our region. I mean, one of the things that we often encounter in the communities where we work is there's a tendency to naturalize the familiar. And, you know, people are caught in their everyday lives and they're moving through. And when they encounter, you know, the everyday injustices of life, they begin to see that as the way of the world. And one of the reasons why mapping has been important to us is because it enables us to visualize human-made decisions that are actually inflicting those injustices and those indignities on these communities. And if these borders are man-made artificial creations, it also requires human beings to resist them. So, you know, we've really tried to expose the radical potential of remapping. And we engage young people, for example, all the time in sort of visual cartographies of their own region, of their own environment, because we've seen it as a way that young people can begin to take ownership and assert agency over those spaces. Clearly, mapping has been a historical tool of the oppressor, right? And so we're in many ways using the tool of the oppressor against the oppressor to raise consciousness among the colonized and the oppressed. It's really very much a part of, it's a very fidede, you know, the idea of integrating into a pedagogy of oppression and raising consciousness. So
it does, I mean, this is a much longer discussion, how certain representational systems have biases built into their codification.
Yeah.
And to what extent, like language, are you able to kind of reassess that kind of latent or invisible authority and produce through some form of novelty a new, a kind of platform of communication that is able to serve as a parallel form of influence to language and intervention, physical intervention.
Exactly.
I mean, it's a really interesting question. This comes from Clementine. Thank you for the lecture. It is a highly successful way to holistically integrate the build and geological environments into a generative and sustainable framework. How do you believe this sort of approach could be applied to additional sites in a context such as rehabilitating and reintegrating immigrants into a community?
We see borders everywhere. I mean, so we're navigating this international border and trying to find passageways through it and ways to erase it and so on. But you know, borders are reproduced in every city everywhere. When we've led architectural studios, focusing on other regions with their own local and regional challenges, we've found, you know, the strategies in our border region are very easily transportable to other sites. And being able to, you know, visualize borders that are invisible and only apparent through praxis has been a real strategy in, you know, dealing with a variety of other issues. We're teaching a studio right now at the University of Arkansas called Political Equator Arkansas, really, which is about seeing these kinds of borders operating in Northwest Arkansas. using the exact same tools that we're experimenting
with. The reproducibility of the border, the invisible reproducibility of the border in our own city in San Diego, it's been a topic of our also research. Obviously, this is about jurisdictional power. And by the way, the Mexus image was exactly to be a kind of, to think post-jurisdiction in this case, the kind of stupidity, right, of how we organize the city based on the abstraction of these arbitrary kind of jurisdictional lines, right, that polarize the man-made with the ecological. I mean, it just gets to that level of the rudimentary kind of common sense, right, that we so by erasing the jurisdictional line and by exposing this other thing, or you know, this we call it a monster, this image of this incredible eight most important regional watersheds across the continent. It just produces, you know, this is something that we do not see. So we are not accustomed to seeing the city beyond its compartmentalization, right? But the point here that in terms of the question is that as we are trying to reimagine the city as hopefully a more inclusive, egalitarian, porous system, I mean, climate change is pushing us to reimagine public space in a way that it might be able to double as a resilient, absorbent, permeable, that's again, a system, right, that can perform intelligently as such in terms of water management, flood management, et cetera. Can we think of spaces in the city also in the context of social emergency? Mm-hmm. So in this sense, it's about even another layer of complexity. But I think that we're working in very specific places where migrants have arrived, where there is incredible urgency and so on. But your question, the last question, really opens the idea that as we, you know, as we reimagine the city through climate, we can also have to reimagine it through social emergency. I mean, that would be to me a kind of important, we mentioned it, the kind of post-shelter idea, or the idea that we have to go beyond hospitality into truly engaging issues of inclusion. And as we, you know, as the city transforms, we transform with the migrant. And I think that that's another kind of dimension of thinking of the politics of empathy. You see what I'm trying to say? The city as a more flexible system for social inclusion.
Well, it, you know, a great answer, both of you. You're proposing a paradigm shift in the way alliances and interdisciplinary collaboration will take place as a kind of engine, a massive and powerful engine of transformation. Here's a question from Daniel Dunn. First, it starts off with a comment. Thank you for your beautiful works and words. It does seem to me that your works improve the material lives of the people in Mexico and the US. In the full implication of your work, it is not also the case that many people will be called on to live a different architecture. That is a real dimension of material wealth. We're gonna have to interpret this here.
I think I get it.
All right.
And we've encountered comments like this before. I think a real diminishment of material wealth. Mm. It's sort of, you know, we've encountered arguments like this before that what we're doing is we are finding ways to stabilize housing with material systems that are built out of waste instead of figuring out how maybe to develop cleaner and shinier houses. I mean, so the idea is, are we just simply accommodating the practices of the poor who assemble housing from whatever materials they can find? Shouldn't we be aiming higher than this? When we've heard arguments like this in the past, you know, it's like, obviously everybody would love, you know, to live in a McMansion in San Diego, right? If they could, and while we all aspire for material improvement, what about the meantime? I mean, you know, the houses that people are building in Tijuana right now are built on very precarious hillsides that are sedimented and falling down into the canyons and every time it rains. And so what we're trying to do is find a way to stabilize existing practices and to, you know, to fortify and stabilize what already happens from the bottom up. We've never been a practice that believes in going and building housing for the poor. That's not the way we've operated. It's about fortifying practices that are already ingenious and ongoing, but need subsidy and support. So
in that sense, it is about addressing the existing real now, right? Because yes, it could be that somebody might be able to move into a wealthier but when will that happen? 60 years from now? What do we do in the meantime is what Fona was mentioning. And how do we then think of infrastructure at that point? That's the reason for me, Evan, I always refer to the kind of socializing of infrastructure just to play with Stan Allen a little bit about, yes, it is about rethinking infrastructure as a mediatory system that can negotiate, formal and informal and temporal flows and dynamics and so on. But it can also be about transition. So can we then think of an acupunctural as we said, infrastructural systems that can support the transition from one state to another, right? So anticipatory infrastructure, this is what, and that became so relevant in our thinking here, because we agree, we would like to really aspire to the improvement of the material context. And that's a question that they ask, who are you to say that these people like to live in, are surrounded by trash? Yeah, so, but that's a reality. So how do we insert ourselves into that reality with new paradigms or new types of, not only definitions, but performative systems that can enable the transformation from the ephemeral event to the permanent.
So in light of that that idea, have you ever confronted a situation where the pre-existing conditions were so dire? And I'm talking about in response to Fona's comment about flooding, that there may be environmental hazards that are so extreme that it would be, in quotes, in the best interest to relocate, maybe in close proximity, the community.
Yes, but by the way, we developed a project in collaboration also with another Colombian former mayor, Sergio Fajardo in Medellin, and we learned a lot from, we developed a project that is called the Medellin Diagram, because basically a lot of publications in architecture were just publishing the buildings of the successes of Medellin, but nobody was talking about the institutional transformations that occurred in order to make that project happen. So we wanted to trace visually those processes and went to work there for a couple of years interviewing many people to really stitch together a set of conceptual tools and so on. Anyway, but one of those interesting strategies that they follow there is that as they were retrofitting informal settlements with very robust infrastructures really of transportation, the gondolas and the library parks and the new bridges and so on, they were discovering that certain housing was located in the route, how to say, in the pathway of water, in certain tributaries of the topography and so on. And so they produced a very intelligent project that we haven't seen in other places, where they relocated those housing units, but they build new social housing in particular sectors of the informal settlement surrounded by service support infrastructures. Similarly, we're trying to imagine this in the informal settlement. I mean, there is so much to say about that site, which is really truly our laboratory in the next 5 years, this informal settlement that crashes against the border wall, because a lot of the trash, as we said, moves from the informal settlement into the estuary, which is in San Diego. But as we suggested, the estuary is not only of San Diego, it's a bioregional asset. We've been working with our partners, discovering that $12 million plus dollars are paid every year just to clean the trash in the estuary. So we've been arguing, can we redirect some of that money to support the transformation of spaces in the informal settlement to prevent the sediment and the trash from reaching the estuary? Right, so which would be a beautiful kind of way of one country enabling the support of another in order to protect common resources. And it is at that point where the retrofitting of spaces, of the habitat, public spaces that perform really to contain and manage some of these flows, it's a similar situation where we are imagining relocating housing mm-hmm. in some of those moments, places of high risk. Right. But then it cannot be like many countries do, okay, we are just going to evict you, right? But it has to be, there has to be a logic and a strategy to reconsolidate those units into new areas. So it's a whole sort of shuffling and reorganization of the system.
Great answer. This question is from Chris Perry, a faculty member in the School of Architecture. Your architecture seems to synthesize a kit of parts sensibility associated with mid-century modernism, as seen in the work of Cedric Price, who coined the term with that of the sensibility of the favela. In the former, could be seen as a more universal architectural language. Given its basis in standard materials and mass production, could the later be seen as vernacular? And if so, could your architecture be seen as situated within the broader local global context of the social, political, and environmental challenges you're mediating, in part through the mediation of these two architectural sensibilities?
You want to expand, Fona, a little bit on, I mean, because this is a direct reference to Jean Prouvaire and to the work that we've been advancing with.
I mean, you know, we've been hugely inspired by Prouvaire for many years, and the idea that prefabricated systems could be combined with local labor to produce emergency infrastructure, social infrastructure, and so forth. So we've actually through a very wonderful partnership and collaboration with architectural historian Bob Rubin, have been thinking about how really to recuperate Prouvaire's legacy for very current urgencies. And, you know, Prouvaire now has really been the subject of like garden follies, and everybody wants a little piece of Prouvaire to sort of decorate their, you know, their gardens and homes, but in fact he had a brilliant idea about how to manufacture housing at scale to deal with, you know, post-war housing issues in France, and exported these ideas around the world and so on. So it's been a real inspiration for us.
And I'm sorry to interrupt. What contribution is Robert Rubin making in particular?
Well, it is an interesting story because, Fona, do you want to just expand on that?
Yeah, sure. So, you know, Bob really sparked our interest in Prouvaire many years ago, and Bob had a very rare Prouvaire kangaroo chair in his possession and decided to auction it off at Sotheby's to raise funds for the housing project at Alacran. And so the economy of scale is just amazing. The chair sold for something like $380,000, which paid for basically the first several stages of construction of a building that's going to house hundreds of people. So it's really quite amazing. And so Bob has really accompanied this process from the start.
Right, and he came and we went to the factory together. I mean, in fact, even before we were talking about this and negotiating this possibility of collaborating to invest in this project, that, you know, the Mecalux frame, which is really where we retrofitted the shelving system, and we just at some point we discovered that we could in fact just shift or change the angle of the base to produce an A-frame, and then from there the whole system operated just by the way it does, clicking. So it was pretty much inspired by the Prouvaire model of the Maison Tropicale, which is really an A-frame in the core of the house, and the perimeter of the house is light. And when you look at some of those incredible images of Prouvaire's frame of this Maison Tropicale, you know, we always thought, you know, Prouvaire belongs to Tijuana, just like Guy Debord belongs in at the border, you know, we call it the border. You saw some of our references to the board. What I'm saying is that just like, you know, there are certain paradigms. I always, you know, love this notion that modernism found its home in the tropics, in South America, really, where this is where actually it makes sense. These large spaces, buildings lifted in pilotis of breezes and cross ventilation could, you know. So there is something about the logic of Prouvaire in providing the scaffold again. But he was not afraid, as many other architects, to let that scaffold be idiosyncratically altered. So he was thinking of refabrication less as a globalizing, a standardized system, but more as a framework to really accept these local idiosyncratic contingencies and evolutionary patterns. So that was very beautiful. And so at that point, just to add to the story that Forna just mentioned, we were in New York as part of an exhibition that we were part of where we first exhibited this project at the Cooper Hewitt. And Bob was there and we were talking and he said, you know what? As you know, Evan and some of you listening, I mean, Bob Rubin became really well known because he, as a PhD candidate at Columbia, he went to Africa to recuperate a couple of the two houses that were still, you know, together of Jean Prouvaire. Jean Prouvaire designed this house called the Maison Tropicale, or the Tropical House, as an emergency housing to really be deployed in Africa. And Bob Rubin studied Jean Prouvaire. He went to Africa and found the houses. He restored them and gave one to MoMA and one to the Pompidou. And he told us at that exhibition that there was a third house. And that third house he found in shambles. There was just a few pieces. So he said, why don't I just send you the house in a container to Tijuana? And so he put the house in the container from Paris and we got it here in San Diego.
Right.
And he said, let us use that to recuperate the legacy of Jean Prouvaire that has been hijacked by museums and galleries into a kind of highly commodified thing. Right. Let's recuperate the social legacy of, and let's do it. It was a beautiful act. And so we are using that as a point of entry into an economic model, which is another thing that Prouvaire thought of in those days. It's an entrepreneurial model of enabling communities to really produce their own housing. So and all these things began to kind of connect the dots. And when and he said, let's begin the project. We have these resources. We have the university. I said, well, okay, I'll sell my share. And he sent us which became foundational. And it's just unbelievable, as Fona was saying, that enabled to pay for the entire infrastructure of the project to begin with. Obviously, there is a cross-subsidy of the factory. There is the investments from the university and a couple of other foundations as well that we facilitated. But just to think that the price of one chair in New York City paid for an entire foundation and infrastructure for an immigrant housing project in Tijuana, it was just amazing.
I know Robert Rubin because I was the director of the architecture galleries when we put on the Three Nomadic Structures exhibition.
That's right.
And his career trajectory is quite fascinating. He made a fortune in Wall Street and decided to leave it all behind, became one of the foremost collectors in the world of Jean Prouvaire's artifacts and buildings, and then went back, as you mentioned, to Columbia to get a PhD in architecture history. That's wonderful. That's wonderful because he kind of is situated within the center of the avant-garde and this very kind of rarefied community of collectors, yet he recognizes that there was a larger ethical mandate behind Prouvaire's work, yeah. and life's work. Yeah. You guys have been enormously generous with your time. I have to say it was a spectacular lecture and so timely, given the fact that there's a confluence of Black Lives Matter, COVID, a global recession. I mean, I could go on. It sounds like a science fiction movie. And to the extent that the two of you have come together and dedicated yourself, your life's work, to a kind of a benevolent model that, as I said before, represents a radical paradigm shift. I think it offers enormous insight and inspiration to the next generation of students. And as I may have mentioned offline prior to starting the lecture, Fona and Teddy, we would love to have you come back, certainly when the masks are off and you're able to meet the students and the faculty in person. And I commend you for your patience and resilience and unwavering commitment to something enormously important at this moment in history. So on behalf of the school, thanks again.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Evan. Thank you. And thank you for
thanks
the
everyone for the questions were fantastic.
Fantastic
thank you
questions
so much.
And your moderation, Evan, and as always excellent. And thank you for pushing us to
Fona, it was wonderful to meet you and Teddy. After all these years, you haven't aged at all. You look as young as ever.
Thank you. At least you have hair.
And keep in touch. All the best.
Yes.
With
no, thank you. Thank you, everyone, thank you for so hosting much. Us. And let's hope to see you in person one day. Let's keep in touch, Evan, okay?
We'll do that. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, everyone.
Bye, everyone. Take care.